Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Take Your Eye Off the Puck, How to Watch Hockey by Knowing Where to Look, by Greg Wyshynski, foreword by Jeremy Roenick, narrated by Barry Abrams. Is hockey hard? I don't know. You tell me. We need to have the strength and power of a football player, the stamina of a marathon runner, and the concentration of a brain surgeon. But we need to put all this together while moving at high speeds on a cold and slippery surface while five other guys use clubs to try and kill us. Oh yeah, did I mention that this whole time we're standing on blades an eighth of an inch thick? Is hockey hard? I don't know, you tell me. Next question. Brendan Shanahan. Forward. Jeremy Roenick. I love my job as an analyst for the NHL on NBC. After playing hockey for most of my life, getting to sit around and talk about the game for a living has made for a pretty nice second career. The team I get to work with, from Liam McHugh, Keith Jones, Mike Milbury, Catherine Tappan, and the rest of the on-air talent, to the crew and NBC staff, is top of the line and makes our broadcasts entertaining and informative. I know we have a lot of fun on the set, and I think our viewers and fans have fun watching us on TV. If we had an unlimited amount of time, I'd like nothing more than to talk about the finer points of the game, all the X's and O's and little plays that make the difference between winning and losing. Unfortunately, we only have a few minutes to recap what's happening before we throw it back to the game action. That's where a book like Take Your Eye Off the Puck comes in. Hockey fans today know more about the game than they probably ever have, but you can watch 10 NHL games every week and still not fully understand what's going on. All the set plays the coaches draw up, the tricks that veteran players know how to pull, the reasons deflected goals aren't lucky, and a million other parts of the game can get overlooked if you aren't watching for them. After listening to this book, you'll have a better understanding of how teams put their rosters together, how power plays and penalty kills are organized, how to get the most out of the advanced stats we're starting to collect, and everything else that happens on the ice. See you at the rink. Introduction. At 14:43 of the second overtime session in Game 5 of the 2014 Stanley Cup Final, Alec Martinez scored the series-winning goal for the Los Angeles Kings, vanquishing the New York Rangers and giving the City of Angels its second cup in 3 years, and in the process, earning me a share of the game-winning goal pool, which kept me awash in in-and-out combo meals for the rest of the weekend. That's what you remember seeing on TV, right? Rangers goalie Henrik Lundqvist burying his gorgeous face in the blue paint of his crease as sticks flew through the air and the Kings mobbed their overtime hero. The black jersey-clad Orange County natives in the stands, leaping up and down in euphoria, trying not to pop their cosmetic surgery stitches. The Rangers players stoically staring across the empty rink, wondering if they'd ever advance that deeply into the postseason again. Perhaps forgetting how hot knife through room temperature butter it is to win in the Eastern Conference. Nothing in organized sports comes close to the unpredictability of a playoff overtime in the NHL and the sudden catharsis or agony that accompanies its finale. Nothing in organized sports comes close to what happened next on that June evening in SoCal, the pageantry of hockey's holy grail being bestowed upon its greatest team. As men on the ice become boys on the pond while they raise the cup to the heavens. But what makes hockey great is that it's not just a moment of visceral thrills or superficial ecstasy. Everything that happens in the game, every goal, every shot, every shift, every save, are the last dominoes to topple over in a strikingly long sequence of events. It's a player lifting the cup, with hundreds of invisible arms lifting it with him. Think of Martinez scoring that goal. He beat Lundqvist to the blocker's side, with a gaping net at which to shoot. pretend you've got this game on your DVR and hit rewind. As a defenseman, Martinez could have decided to lead the scoring rush out of his own zone, or let the forwards handle it as he hung back. But he skated up with them, giving the Kings a brief odd-man rush before the exhausted Rangers back-checked. Martinez passed to center Kyle Clifford, who passed to winger Tyler Toffoli, who skated into the attacking zone and unloaded a shot on Lundqvist. Henrik made the save, but couldn't angle the rebound to a safe place in the zone, instead sending it to an on-rushing Martinez. Why was Martinez open for the shot? Because defenseman Kevin Klein of the Rangers decided to take Clifford as he drove the net, while both John Moore and Mats Zuccarello decided to defend Toffoli's shot. That left Martinez unmarked for what amounted to a hockey layup. Dial it back a few more moments. How did the Kings get out of their own zone so quickly and effectively? Well, the Rangers rushed two forecheckers deep into the attacking zone. Zuccarello, their sniper, was late getting from the neutral zone to the front of the Kings' net. A centering feed by Derek Brassard from Gretzky's office was intercepted by Matt Green, who passed the puck to Martinez, and away he went down the ice. Dial it back even a few more moments. Why was Martinez on the ice at that point in the game? Because the Kings' top defensive pairing of Drew Doughty and Jake Muzzin came off on a change, having skated a 50-second shift about a minute earlier. On came Martinez, Green, and the Kings' fourth line, which coach Daryl Sutter rolled with confidence throughout the postseason, allowing his top scorers some much-needed rest. Okay, now pump up that DVR rewind to unforeseen speeds, like well beyond times four. Dial it back a few months. Where did this court of Kings come from? Well, Clifford had anchored the Kings' fourth line since the 2013 postseason. Toffoli was a rookie on the 2013-14 Kings, settling into a role alongside Clifford. Martinez skated with Green during the Kings' 2012 Stanley Cup season, winning his first ring. He entered 2013-14 in a numbers crunch on the blue line. There was no promise that Martinez would be a regular for the Kings, but he earned his ice time with solid play, and there he was in Game 5. Your DVR remote should be smoking by now, but who cares? Dial it back a few years. Why was Martinez a King? He was drafted by the team in the fourth round of the 2007 entry draft, number 95 overall. The Kings needed defensive prospects in their system, and the Michigan-born, Miami University of Ohio prospect intrigued them. But then, the team drafted star Drew Doughty and three more defensemen in the following year, so Martinez gestated in the minor leagues until 2010-2011, when he played 60 games as a rookie for L.A. The next season, he was a Stanley Cup champion. 2 years later, he was a playoff legend. What if on that fateful afternoon in 2007, the Kings had opted to draft Cade Fairchild instead, a 19-year-old from Duluth who went number 96 overall and played a total of 5 games in the NHL? What if Martinez never emerged from the pack of other young defensemen? What if Martinez and Green never clicked, or Clifford and Toffoli? What if Daryl Sutter hadn't decided to put the energy line out there in double overtime? What if the Kings didn't execute that passing play? What if the Rangers hadn't gotten their wires crossed on that shift? What if Lundqvist pulled off a miraculous save? What if Martinez had flubbed the shot? If ifs and buts were candy and nuts, then hockey would be Willy Wonka. When a team hoists the Stanley Cup, it's lifting the weight of hundreds of thousands of decisions along with it. Decisions made on the ice and off that all led to that moment. One variable changes, and the fate of the team could change with it. It's like the butterfly effect. Okay, given the sport, maybe the butterfly goalie effect. If you're listening to this book, it's because you're curious about those decisions. You're someone who knows that the game goes so far beyond what's captured by that big swinging television camera at center ice. You understand that taking your eye off the puck allows one to fully appreciate every other aspect of hockey, and thus appreciate where the fickle little biscuit is headed next, and who might be there to stop it. The NHL is still seen by the non-believers as a crude, brutal, foreign game, where two guys punching each other in the face is more symbolic of the sport's virtues than cerebral athleticism and strategy. This book explains why hockey is actually the perfect marriage of strategy and ingenuity, of preparation and improvisation, and of wisdom and will. Why every position played and decision made is a product of history, savvy, and instinct. Why taking your eye off the puck means opening your eyes to the beautiful nuance of hockey, and on occasion, to two guys punching each other in the face because they're paid to do so. What a life. Chapter 1. What the heck is going on out there? You know what I love about hockey? The speed. Not just the speed of the skaters, who can glide as fast as 30 miles an hour for the fastest of them. It's the movement of 10 bodies on the ice, the ones coming off the bench, the chasing of the puck to all corners of the rink, and how it all resets in an instant depending on who earns possession, like birds flying in formation. Baseball, by comparison? Like watching a slug crawl across flypaper. Basketball, by comparison? Like watching a hockey game made up of 250 24-second power plays and penalty kills, except you only have to watch the last 4 minutes of each game to feel fulfilled. Football, by comparison? Physicality, frequent changing of personnel, but a game flow that resembles a clogged ketchup nozzle. Anyone who has watched a hockey game with two teams trading chances for several minutes knows what's up. There's nothing that approaches the velocity, synchronicity, and unpredictability of the sport. It's controlled chaos at times, machine-like precision at others. This is something that you can only experience in the arena, or the stadium, depending on how much cash the NHL decides on grabbing in a given season with its outdoor games. Television, given the current tech and its limitations, can't convey everything that makes live hockey so exhilarating. Case in point, they never have to make the puck glow in the arena so you can locate it, or give it a comet tail. For years, I've proffered the theory that there aren't people who don't like hockey, but rather people who have yet to let the light of hockey into their hearts. And the best way to bring these heathens to our religion of choice is to get them to one of our frozen temples and watch a game live. But once they get there, they might ask, what the heck is going on? Doing lines. For decades, the basic setup of a team's forward group has remained static. You have the first line. This is home to your best offensive skill players, the group that's supposed to give opponents fits. Stars, captains, creatures of ego. Usually a Canadian or two, 18 to 21 minutes in time on ice. The second line. Also home to dynamic offensive players, but frequently ones who can play well defensively too. Coaches won't hesitate to go power versus power by putting this group out against another team's top line, because this can be where the team's best defensive center can be found, such as Boston's Patrice Bergeron. It's called the second line in honor of the time it takes for fans to argue that it's actually the first line based on the stats, 18 to 21 minutes in time on ice. The third line. This is the traditional checking line, playing against one of the opponent's top two lines. Here is where you'll find centers who are face-off specialists and wingers who grind like Miley Cyrus, one of whom is usually a solid scorer who doesn't fit into the top six, but picks up the trash left behind by his tenacious line mates. 14 to 17 minutes in time on ice. The fourth line. You're home for muckers, meatheads, and misanthropes. This is the energy line that features checking pests and brawlers whose task is to cry havoc, let slip the dogs of war, and collect penalty minutes. But for all the circus music they can orchestrate, a strong fourth line can frequently be an X factor in a given playoff series, 6 to 11 minutes of ice time. Teams roll three defensive pairings, which stack up thusly. The first pairing. Your best two-way stud defenseman, capable of eating up minutes, shutting down foes, and contributing to the offense. Sometimes paired with the team's second-best defenseman. More often paired with a defenseman who makes up for his shortcomings. Example, a stay-at-home player to help the offensively active star defenseman. 22 to 26 minutes of ice time. The second pairing. Your next best defenseman. Perhaps home to that offensive whiz who isn't quite first pairing solid on the defensive front. Perhaps home to two depth defensemen who have better shutdown credentials than the top pairing. Regardless, like the big dogs, they see special teams time too. 19 to 22 minutes of ice time. The third pairing. Usually a pairing with some glaring deficiency, like size, skating ability, or a lack of experience. The fifth defenseman leads an exciting life because he might have a new friend every other night, depending on the coach's decisions. Things you'll hear about them, well, of course they scored against the third pairing, or great effort despite being the third pairing. 15 to 18 minutes of ice time. Now, how do we arrive at the different combinations of players at forward and on defense? Sometimes it'll come down to handedness. If a forward group has a dynamic right winger, it might look to pair a left-handed center with him because it's naturally easier for him to get that winger the puck. Ditto a right-handed center and a left winger, although it should be said that right-handed centers are rarer in the league. Of the top 60 centers in the 2013-2014 season, only 21 were right-handed. On defense, handedness is much more of a factor in creating pairings. Defensemen who play in an offhand position, a right-handed defenseman playing left defense, for example, face a number of challenges in adjustment, from keeping the puck in the zone to effectively passing to their defensive partners. For that reason, teams will specifically trade for a defenseman who is left-handed if they have a surplus of righties, and vice versa. One of the reasons the St. Louis Blues acquired Jay Bouwmeester in 2013, for example, was because he was a top-pairing lefty. They did it again after the following season in acquiring Carl Gunnarsson for Roman Polak. As I say, to get a left-handed defenseman, you rob Peter to pay Paul. We have to give up a right-handed defenseman and a quality person, says Blues GM Doug Armstrong. Robbing Peter? That's how important a left-handed defenseman is. But most of the time, the combinations at forward and on defense have everything to do with time-tested chemistry. Some player styles just mesh, whether it's a winger who can dig the puck to a sniping center, or a small playmaking pivot whose hulking winger protects him. Or, on defense, if a puck-moving defender is allowed to freelance thanks to his rock-solid pylon, defensive defenseman, who is responsible in his own zone. Or, if the average to mediocre center is friends off the ice with Phil Kessel. That, too. Most coaches in the NHL design their forward groups by twos, pairing two players who have solid chemistry, usually a center and a winger, and then adding whatever type of player might best help them excel. For years, Sidney Crosby and Chris Kunitz had such chemistry, as the former's playmaking ability combined well with the latter's speed and ability to generate offense off the rush. To round out their line, the Pittsburgh Penguins would match them with a big-bodied grinder like Pascal Dupuis, who could create space for both of them. And a trio like that will stay together through thick and thin. Unless, of course, they're coached by Michel Therrien, in which case their line will be broken up if they go scoreless on, like, two straight shifts. Getting benched. NHL rules mandate that the player's bench must be 24 feet long and be able to accommodate 14 players, with protective glass tall enough to separate the animals from the zoo patrons. They also mandate that the doors to the player's bench must swing inward rather than out into the path of speeding players. And the fact this needs to be stated in the official rule book is glorious validation of hockey's traditional disregard for knee ligaments. Provided you're not watching a superhuman freak like Erik Karlsson or Alex Ovechkin, the average shift of an NHL skater is going to last between 45 and 50 seconds, A top-pairing NHL defenseman plays between 26 and 30 shifts per night, while a top-line NHL forward will have between 23 and 26 shifts per game, with the acknowledgement that some trend higher or lower. All of this is to say that the bench area sees more action than a subway turnstile, only with slightly fewer weirdos. Players have to be within 5 feet of the bench and not engaged in the play when changing before a teammate can hop on to replace him, or else they run the risk of earning a too-many-men-on-the-ice penalty, provided the officials actually see it. But of course, we all do when a TV analyst inevitably circles 6 or 7 players on his monitor to shame the refs. Keep in mind that if a puck hits either player making a change accidentally, it's not a penalty. That's a very common misconception, especially for fans at the game screaming bloody murder over a rule they've never read. Also important, the NHL rulebook actually states that a player has to change at the bench and use no other exit. A darn shame for the home team, which should totally be allowed to use the Zamboni door to get off the ice during exhausting penalty kills. Let's make home ice advantage an actual advantage beyond raucous fans and familiar betting. Head coaches typically manage the forwards. You'll see him tap a few players on the shoulders, getting them ready for their next shift, and then have another line on deck. When there's a chance for a change, if a team controls the puck or has it deep into the opposition's zone, there's a replacement for each player who leaves the ice. Center for center, wingers for wingers, each player immediately knowing his role for the next shift. Frequently, the players will call out each other's names so both know who is replacing whom. Working in concert with the head coach is an assistant coach in charge of changing the defense. Sometimes the defense pairings will be influenced by the forwards being sent out. Example, having the top pairing playing with the top offensive line. And sometimes the pairings will be determined by whom the opponents put over the boards, as you always want your best shutdown defenseman to face the other team's top line, and have that D-man frequently paired with the team's best checking line. Here's where things can get a little OCD for coaches. Line matching. I never liked playing for those coaches. Kind of annoying, recalled former NHL winger-turned-broadcaster Mike Johnson. A coach will set up the next 3 lines after the one that's on the ice, but then, seeing what the other team puts out on the fly, he'll tell players at the very last second that it's their turn to hit the ice, even if they're not the next line in the rotation. That's because the opposing coach has done something, put out his top line, put out his bruising fourth line, to influence the line match. For some coaches, this is the perfect system through which to defeat an opponent. For most observers, it's a handy way to unbalance your players' ice time to their detriment. Because in a league where the margins of victory are this slim, stapling the hindquarters of offensive players to the bench in lieu of overplaying a checking line is an express train to second-guessing. What to watch when you're watching the game. So that's what happens at the benches, but once the lines are deployed, there are a few things to keep an eye on as you watch the game, in the arena or on TV. We'll expand on some of these in later chapters, but for now, time on ice. In general, the average shift length for an NHL player is around 45 seconds. It was 44.24 in the 2013-2014 season. This stands in contrast with shift lengths even a decade ago, which were 7% longer, according to the blog Arctic Ice Hockey. Go back to the freewheeling 1980s, and the shift length was upwards of 60 seconds. But fret not about the player's health. Being that it was the 1980s, their bodies weren't taxed with playing any defense. That's one of the keys for players. How much heavy lifting are they doing on each shift? The Detroit Red Wings would attempt to keep players like Henrik Zetterberg at around 40-second shifts in order to maintain their stamina for later in the game. Keep an eye on which players have been out there the longest, but also what they've been doing. A defensive player running around in his own zone as an offense passes the puck around is going to be gassed at some point. If nothing else, you'll appreciate when a defensive player makes a Herculean effort to clear the puck before gliding over to the bench, winded. As for those forwards who remain on the ice for too long, we'll pass the mic to venerable blogger Tyler Dello.
Being on the ice after a minute is sort of like being in a bar after 1 a.m. There's no guarantee that something bad will happen. It's possible that something good will happen, but the odds are slanted heavily in favor of something bad.
The Star Chamber. Hockey isn't like basketball, where you see stars going head-to-head off the dribble. The Crosby versus Ovechkin banner headlines on NHL.com are fun and all, but if you tallied up the time the two are actually on the ice together, it's roughly smaller than the Wicked Witch of the East's screen time before Dorothy dropped a house on her. Instead, watch how teams decide to defend players like Ovechkin and Crosby, which defensive pairings they throw out there on the reg, which forwards are assigned to shadow them, and then watch the star player's line changes and what sort of matchups his coach is trying to secure. How many shifts begin in the offensive zone? How many are in the defensive zone? When Crosby faces the Montreal Canadiens, they make sure both center Thomas Plekanec and defenseman P.K. Subban are shadowing him. When Crosby plays the New York Rangers, they simply want to get defenseman Mark Stahl to defend against him. And by defend, we mean vigorously cross-check him in the back of the head without any repercussions. As we mentioned earlier, it's a chess match within the game for many coaches, and the star players are the kings among pawns. Zone starts. One of the great innovations in advanced stats is tracking zone starts, which tell us plenty about how a team uses a player and the confidence that player has earned. The offensive zone is where you'll glean the most. Rookies, for example, are often protected with a large amount of starts in the attacking zone, mostly because the defensive side of the game has a hell of a learning curve in the NHL, but also to maximize their offensive chances and bolster their confidence. In the 2014-2015 season, David Pastrnak was an 18-year-old rookie sensation for the Boston Bruins, scoring 27 points in 46 games. The percentage of his shifts that began in the offensive zone? 47.4%, the highest for any player with at least 300 minutes played. The same protection can be found for some defensemen who are either dynamic offensively or struggle a bit in their own end. Brian Campbell, a great offensive defenseman, started 40.7% of his shifts in the offensive zone and just 26% in the defensive zone in 2014-2015. So often did his partner, rookie teenager Aaron Ekblad, thereby protecting him as well. It works the other way, too. Forwards with the highest percentage of defensive zone starts are likely also ones with rather high face-off winning percentages, moderate to low ice time, and the scoring prowess to match. That's why it's always more impressive when a player posts an outstanding offensive season when starting most of his shifts in the D zone. Look no further than Phil Kessel in 2013-2014, who tallied 54 points at 5-on-5 despite starting 37.3% of his shifts in the defensive zone. Which, of course, spoke to the Toronto Maple Leafs' ridiculous inability to get out of their own zone at times. Thanks, Randy Carlyle. Breakouts and entries. How a team gets out of its zone and how it enters the opposing zone are like bread slices around a barbecue sandwich. They're pretty much going to determine whether you've got something cohesive or tremendously sloppy, but potentially delicious. When a team enters the attacking zone, it can chip and chase, dump and chase, or attempt to set up around the blue line. How much room an opposing defense surrenders at the line, and how smart the offensive team is with the puck, can make or break scoring chances. When a team leaves its own zone, it's trying to organize in order to break down an opponent's forechecking system. The neutral zone. This is where the game is won and lost. The seeds of a play are planted in how a team breaks out of its own zone. The neutral zone is where we find out if those seeds will grow into a mighty oak or be devoured by a hungry squirrel. This is where the defensive team will set up in an effort to force a turnover,
and where an attacking team will decide how to proceed into the offensive zone. And that decision is going to dictate whether or not its time with the puck will result in a scoring chance being generated. Analytics blogger Eric Tulski found that there was a significant difference in offensive tactics from the neutral zone. The choice between dumping the puck in or attempting to carry it into the zone carry major repercussions. It appears that how a team gets the puck into the zone is as important as how often they do it, he wrote. Maintaining possession of the puck at the blue line, carrying or passing the puck across the line, means a team will generate more than twice as much offense as playing dump and chase. Yet, watch how many times teams simply dump the puck over the defenseman and hope for the best while ceding possession back to the defense. Face-off strategy. The face-off doesn't just determine possession. It determines what the next two or three moves for a team will be after the draw. That's first going to be determined by the face-off man. Is he trying to draw it back to a shooter? Is he trying to tie up the puck in the dot to cause a little chaos? Did he actually lose the face-off on purpose in order to keep the puck deep in the attacking zone? Because while it'll do nothing for his face-off percentage, it's at times a reasonable tactic. Obstruction. Okay, tracking how players hook, hold, pick, and prevent creativity might sound about as exciting as watching paint dry during a public television pledge drive. But hear me out. Seeing how players use these sneaky little moments to stymie an opponent or help each other out is the epitome of teamwork. How a pick in the zone can spring a sniper for a scoring attempt, or how a little interference prevents an attacking player from getting into a scoring position. Is it a goal-sucking pox on the game that's ruining hockey for future generations? Sure, but it's also not going anywhere. Well, unless the referees decide to actually call obstruction on a consistent basis, but that would mean they're calling all of this on the level and aren't completely conspiring against your team. Those moments when the puck accidentally hits the referee during play and it screws up everything and you're convinced he's conspiring against your team? You know those moments. The goalies. Are they active participants as third defensemen, or do they remain in their crease when the puck is dumped in? Where are they directing rebounds? How often are they earning face-offs? How active are they in policing their own crease? And perhaps most of all, what's on their masks? Because in a league that preaches homogeny of uniforms and literally wants its players to be just one of a collection of numbers, the goalie mask is one of the lone bastions of individuality. The battle zone. There are individual battles all over the ice during a game, but the one I focus on is always the one right in front of the crease. The constant jostling for position between defensemen and forwards can be downright brutal. The jittery peekaboo movement of a goaltender as he tries to keep his eye on the shooter through two behemoths on his doorstep is a source of amusement. We might not have too many true garbage collectors in the NHL on the level of a Dave Andrechuk any longer, but we'll always have huge bodies doing their best to take the goalie's eyes away. The less a goalie can see, the better the chance that someone's putting a puck behind him. Question. Why pull the goalie? Answer. There are two reasons to pull your goalie. The first is when there's a delayed penalty, giving your team an extra attacker until the other team touches the puck to halt play. The second is when a team is trailing late in a game and the goaltender heads to the bench for a sixth skater. This usually happens with less than 2 minutes remaining in a game, although we've seen aggressive and somewhat maniacal coaches like Patrick Waugh pull his keeper with more than 13 minutes remaining in a game and trailing by 4 goals, hence maniacal. Does it work? Andrew Thomas, in the Journal of Quantitative Analysis, found that 30% of the goals scored with one net empty were scored by the team with the empty net. A research paper by David Beaudoin and Tim Swartz of Simon Fraser University on the 2007-2008 season found that teams playing 6-on-5 score a goal every 8.5 minutes,
which is far better than the 28.6 minutes for home teams and 26.2 minutes for road teams at 5-on-5. Another factor in favor of the extra attacker, the researchers found that 84 penalties were called on the team with the lead versus 44 called on the team with the extra attacker, a nearly 1-to-2 ratio. Pull the goalie, get a power play, apparently. War on Ice, the brilliant NHL stats site, ran 100,000 simulations to see whether the trailing team ties the game before the leading team scores another goal into an empty net. They found that the probability the trailing team ties the game is at its apex at 180 seconds remaining in the game when compared to the probability that the other team scores, or potentially lose the game if the opponent sends the puck into the gaping maw of your net. A word about empty net goals. They're not counterfeit, nor do the players see them that way. First, because every goal next to their names is a goal, whether it was into an empty net, or deflected in, or scored off their moneymaker. When it comes to contract talks, it doesn't matter how it was scored, just that it was scored. Second, because scoring an empty netter effectively ends the game, final nail in the coffin style. Which is why you'll see teams put out star players of questionable defensive prowess in the last 2 minutes to find the open net and squeeze out the last breaths from an opponent. We're looking at you, Alex Ovechkin. Question: how do they keep stats at an NHL game? Answer: with a tiny little pencil and a scorecard inside the game magazine, obviously. Wait, no, that's baseball. Official scoring at a hockey game is a multi-person task that involves a multitude of focuses. The jobs dramatically changed in the 1998-1999 season when real-time scoring was adopted by the league. Previously, shots that were blocked or missed weren't counted, among other stats. But that season, the league began having two stats entry scorers, two time-on-ice scorers for home and away teams, and an event coordinator inside a room in the upper reaches of the arena, inputting data into computer programs that tabulate these numbers in real time. These scorers can use video review to confirm on-ice events, but frequently rely on each other and spotters inside the room to attempt to accurately collect the information. How accurate is it? As accurate as a human can get it. That's why many of the advanced stats we have in today's game that measure time on ice and puck possession are still only as good as the individuals collecting that data. More on how that might all radically change in the last chapter. But if your question really is, does the home team get a little favoritism from the home team scorers? Then the answer is, it depends on the category. Most arenas are fairly accurate when it comes to shot attempts and time on ice, but a category like hits has become a punchline because A, it's totally subjective, and B, some scorers have notoriously pumped up the hits total for the home team's resident checker. But hey, it's not all bad. It puts food on Cal Clutterbuck's table. Chapter 2: Forwards and Systems Overload. Picture the world of hockey like it's Hogwarts. The general manager walks down a long, candlelit dining room aisle to your seat in front of the other young offensive wizards, carrying a weathered hat that smells of hockey gear and disappointment. He lowers it onto your head, and an animated mouth appears. Where will you be sorted? You have the flexibility of a senior citizen in skinny jeans, so you figure goaltending is out. You're a bit undersized, and you shy away from the rough stuff, so you're pretty sure it won't be on defense. Your vision's perfect, so you won't be an on-ice official. Your heart isn't a cocktail of rage and depression with a megalomaniacal complex, so you certainly aren't a coach.
Yes, yes, I see, growls the hat.
You're left with three options. Seeing as you're of average height and weight and handle your face-offs like a child learning to use chopsticks, playing center is out. You're a left-handed shot, maybe you'll be placed on your natural side on left wing to ward off defensemen along the boards as you carry through the zone. Or maybe the hat knows what kind of wicked sniper you fancy yourself as and will place you on your off wing on the right side.
Yes, you've been sorted to the House of Sniperin, the hat rumbles. Sweet. Right wing. Pumping pucks from the circle like your name was Brett Hull. Endorsement deals, all-star game appearances, long-term high cap hit contracts the team will regret within a few years. The world is yours, sniper. Ah, but what could have been at another forward spot?
Going offensive. The center is that person in your office who somehow knows how to fix the printer, unclog the toilet, change the coffee machine filters, and run the Super Bowl pool. The center gets the play going off the faceoff, but then transitions to a support role. In the offensive zone, that means positioning oneself to create a play when the winger has the puck. It depends on where the wings fly. If one winger has the puck and the other is set for a shot from the circle or the slot, the center goes to the net, either for a screen or a backdoor play on a pass. If one of those wingers is closer to the net, then the center will drop back to the high slot for a shot. It also depends on what kind of center is on the ice. Someone like Joe Thornton of the San Jose Sharks is a playmaker, much more likely to hang at the half boards, the straight section of boards between the goal line and the blue line, and command the offense, than aggressively crash the net. Sniping centers like Steven Stamkos and Jeff Carter are more likely to be found in a shooting lane. No matter who the center is or what they're looking to accomplish, they all have the same responsibility, assisting the wingers in the offensive zone if they're outnumbered, and hauling ass back the other way as soon as the puck is turned over. Like we said, the center has more jobs than a kid saving for college. But the wingers? A list of their responsibilities in the offensive zone breaks down as follows. 1. Hit people in the corners. 2. Score. 3. Failing to accomplish number 2, find someone else who can. In theory, all three forwards are working in concert to create offensive chances, which is what you see in a well-executed cycle. Cycle like the Sedins. Larry Robinson is a Hall of Fame defenseman and a Stanley Cup-winning coach. Back in his playing days in the 1970s and 1980s, preventing three forwards from cycling in the offensive zone was easy. Just clutch, grab, interfere, and generally pummel them with little to no recourse. But you can't do that in today's NHL, which is why the offensive zone is fertile ground for the cycle to work its magic. What you're trying to do is keep possession of the puck, because that is the key in the offensive zone, but you're also trying to get the other team to start running around, Robinson told NHL.com in 2011. You can almost create a pick situation because the defense is running around so much. It's like a set play in basketball where you're trying to create an open shot. If you love the team aspect of hockey, then the cycle is your catnip. It requires synchronization, timing, physicality, and above all else, an understanding of teammates' tendencies. It also helps if you're identical twins, as Henrik and Daniel Sedin turned the cycle into something symphonic, to the point where Cycle Like the Sedins is praise of the highest order. Here's how it works. Picture a triangle with two corners facing the boards. One forward, F1, has the puck toward the left corner. Another forward, F2, is trailing him at the right corners. The top corner of the triangle finds that third forward, F3, in the high slot. The F1 moves the puck back to the F2 along the boards, and the F2 then becomes the left corner of the triangle. The F3 skates over to the right corner, where the F2 was previously. The F1 who originally had the puck? That forward moves back to the top corner in the high slot, with three options. Preparing for a shot, preparing to get back on defense in the event of a turnover, or preparing to hop back into the cycle should it continue.
Again, it's about tendencies. At some point, two cyclers might hook up for a set play, with one breaking the cycle to go to the net on a feed from the other. Or the wheel just churns in the corner for a bit, getting closer and closer to the goal line, trying to get the defense tuckered out and out of position. You know what else tuckers out defenders? 200 pounds of human blunt force crashing into them in the corners. Human wrecking balls. One of my favorite line pairings in hockey history is the crash line, center Bobby Holík with wingers Mike Peluso and Randy McKay. They were the checking line for the 1995 Stanley Cup champion New Jersey Devils, but in name only. The crash was a reference to their ferocious forechecking, which created more offensive chances than some of the more traditional goal-scoring lines did. If advanced stats existed in the mid-1990s, one assumes they'd be puck possession leaders. Also, hockey arguments would have been exponentially more nuanced and annoying in the mid-1990s. That line was the first to make me appreciate the human wrecking ball aesthetic of forechecking. An offensive player chips the puck in. It then becomes a combination of chess match and blunt force trauma. Ideally, you never want to dump the puck in and have to chase it. You want to keep possession. But here's the thing. NHL defensemen are really, really good. So sometimes you just have to dump and chase, even if it means giving up possession of the puck. The first man in on the forecheck is called the F1, followed by the F2 and F3. The first guy in should force them to angle it up the wall. "We were very aggressive, pinching in our defense," said former Nashville Predators assistant Brent Peterson. "Some teams don't pinch in their defense at all. It's all based on what a coach thinks his team is best at. The bottom line is that in this league, you have to be right on the defenseman's asses." Here are a few different forechecking options that teams can deploy. The 2-1-2 forecheck. This is the most common forechecking system.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.